Hello again to everyone. My name is Maria Victoria Mateos, hematologist at the University Hospital of Salamanca in Spain. And thanks again to Myeloma Patients Europe for inviting me to this meeting. And I will address now the topic of immunotherapy in the treatment of patients with multiple myeloma, as well as amyloidosis. Here you can see my conflict of interest, and maybe something that you know is that one of the hallmarks of cancer is to try to avoid the immune destruction. And this is a mechanism that it is very common in almost all cancers. But is this concept also applicable to multiple myeloma? And you have to know that the answer is yes, because here in this picture, you can see how the plasma cells in yellow try to proliferate, and in order to proliferate, they create an environment completely immunosuppressed, and the T lymphocytes and the B lymphocytes do not work very well because plasma cells want to be the key players in order to proliferate. And throughout when we utilize the immunotherapy, what we are going to utilize is the power of all these immune cells in order to try to attack the plasma cells proliferating in the bone marrow. And you have to know that the immunotherapy is not something completely new in multiple myeloma. And in fact, the allogeneic stem cell transplantation was one of the first concepts in which the normal lymphocytes are trying to attack the plasma cells. Interferon was also a very old drug utilized in patients with multiple myeloma, and the immunomodulatory drugs have also this immunomodulatory effect. Here you can see plasma cell bone marrow microenvironment with different targets that we can utilize as immunotherapy in multiple myeloma. And the first one is CD38. CD38 is quite commonly expressed on the surface of the plasma cells, and it is possible to attack it throughout the monoclonal antibody daratumumab with a direct anti-tumor activity, but also with an immunomodulatory effect. And daratumumab was the first monoclonal antibody so far approved in multiple myeloma as single agent. But isatuximab is another anti-CD38 monoclonal antibody with a similar but not completely identical mechanism of action. And these monoclonal antibodies emerged for the treatment of patients with multiple myeloma because when myeloma patients had been already treated with proteasome inhibitors and immunomodulatory drugs, and they were refractory to bortezomib, carfilzomib, lenalidomide, and pomalidomide, the outcome was quite poor. And daratumumab, but this is also applicable to isatuximab, were able to cover this unmet medical need. And you know, for example, right now, how daratumumab is present across the different stages of the disease. Since late advanced stage of the disease, in first or second relapse, even in the upfront setting in combination with the standard of care, and even in the smoldering myeloma population, as I previously told you in the other talk. This is an example, daratumumab in combination with VMP in the newly diagnosed myeloma patients, in this case, transplant ineligible, with a benefit not only in terms of progression-free survival, but also in overall survival. And the same is applicable to DARA in combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone, with a very important benefit in progression-free survival. And at European Hematology Association Congress, we had the opportunity to see how this combination resulted also into a benefit in overall survival. But this is not only applicable to patients with multiple myeloma, but also to patients with amyloidosis. And daratumumab in combination with the standard of care, Cyborg-D, has been evaluated in the phase 3 Andromeda study conducted in patients with primary amyloidosis with a significant benefit. And in fact, this is important for you patients. Daratumumab in combination with Cyborg-D has been the first combination so far approved for the patients with primary amyloidosis. And the rationale for the approval is the higher hematological complete response rate observed when the data was added to CyBorD. This was the primary endpoint, but in addition, the higher probability for achieving hematological complete response rate was observed in all different subgroup of patients, even patients with advanced stage of the disease, with cardiac involvement, with kidney involvement, and even when the 11-14 translocation was also present. This translated also into an benefit in terms of what we call overall response rate, but I think that is very important to evaluate the complete response rate, that it was the primary endpoint, and especially the progression-free survival. This is a modified progression-free survival, but definitely puts in context that when we add data to map to CyBorD, the response is going to be better, and the durability of the response is going to be longer, and this is translated into this benefit in terms of progression-free survival. And isatuximab is a similar anti-CD38 monoclonal antibody that is also under investigation in late advanced stage of the disease in combination with pomalidomide and dexamethasone, carfilzomib, in the first line of therapy, and even also in smoldering myeloma patients. So CD38 as target has been crucial in order to establish the role of immunotherapy in multiple myeloma. And CD38 are taking part of the treatment of our patients with multiple myeloma. Another target is, this is what you can see here, SLAMF7. And we can target this target with elotuzumab. This is another monoclonal antibody with a dual mechanism of action. But at the end of the day, the killing of the plasma cells is going to occur. However, when elotuzumab was evaluated as single agent, elotuzumab doesn't work. Elotuzumab needs to be combined with immunomodulatory agents like lenalidomide or pomalidomide, because when this combination occurred, there is going to be a potentiation of the immune cells in order to destroy the plasma cells. And this has been observed in this phase 3 randomized study, and elotuzumab in combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone is a standard of care we can utilize, not in all European countries, but in most of them, in a combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone. But also it is possible to combine pomalidomide with elotuzumab, and this phase 2 randomized study showed a significant benefit also for this combination. Where are we going to use these other monoclonal antibodies like elotuzumab in combination with Lendex or with pomalidomide and dexamethasone? Basically, in the relapse and non-refractory situation, in first relapse, in second or third relapse, in combination with lenalidomide or pomalidomide. And I would like to say that in principle, elotuzumab will not be utilized as part of the first line of therapy. If we continue with this slide, evaluating other potential targets for immunotherapy in multiple myeloma, we have to go to BCMA. And BCMA is one of the newest targets expressed on the surface of the plasma cell that we can attack throughout immunotherapy strategies, and we can utilize antibody drug conjugates, T-cell engagers or bispecific monoclonal antibodies, or the CAR-Ts. And I would like to briefly explain in which, well, how these novel immunotherapy strategies work in patients with multiple myeloma. And in principle, and first of all, why we need this BCMA targeted therapy. If I showed you how after bortezomib, carfilzomib, lenalidomide, and pomalidomide, anti-CD38 emerged. But when patients exhausted also the anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies, the survival is quite poor, and in principle, there is not any standard of care in order to rescue patients already treated with these conventional agents. And this is basically the rationale for the generation of new standard of care, like in this case, BCMA-targeted therapy. The first strategy are immunoconjugated monoclonal antibodies. And these monoclonal antibodies is represented by belantamab mafodotin, already approved by the European Medicines Agency for the treatment of relapse and refractory myeloma patients. And the mechanism of action is basically the release of a cytotoxic agent within the plasma cell, resulting into the killing of the plasma cell. And belantamab mafodotin demonstrated to be effective in a series of approximately 100 relapse and refractory myeloma patients, all of them what we call triple refractory. So they were refractory to proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, and anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies. And in this situation, belantamab was effective. We have to take care about the safety profile because the toxicity profile is new. It can induce thrombocytopenia, and it's quite manageable, as well as ocular toxicity in terms of keratopathy, but it is quite frequent, observed in over 70% of the patients. But however, you have to see that the symptomatology the patient refer is observed as a dry eye or blurred vision in no many patients, no more than approximately 20% of the patients. And what is important, it is reversible, and over 90% of the patients recover this toxicity, and it's quite manageable with dose interruptions as well as reduction of the doses with no impact in the quality of life. And I would like to remark that the capacity of the patients receiving belantamab for driving or for reading ordinary print while they were receiving on treatment was not impaired by the treatment with belantamab mafodotin. How are we going to integrate belantamab mafodotin in the treatment of patients with multiple myeloma? You know that today is allocated to these triple refractory myeloma patients, or in principle, those patients already exposed to proteasome inhibitors, IMiDs, as well as anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies. But this is the summary for belantamab, and the second step is to go to the CAR-Ts. And you know that the CAR-Ts are also quite effective. You know that the BCMA CAR-Ts means that we have to extract the T lymphocytes from the patients. These T lymphocytes are going to be genetically modified in order to deliver to our patients these T lymphocytes modified with a signal in order to go directly to attack the BCMA expressed on the surface of the plasma cells. And BCMA CAR-Ts resulted very effective because in this meta-analysis in which the outcome for more than 600 patients with myeloma treated with BCMA CAR-T was analyzed, overall, the overall response rate was 80%. And this means that this therapy is very effective. This is IDCEL, the first BCMA CAR-T so far approved by FDA, and we are awaiting the approval here in Europe with very positive data in terms of overall response rate, as well as progression-free survival and even overall survival. And the same is applicable to this pivotal phase 2 KARMA study. This trial will result into the approval of IDCEL here in Europe. And again, you can see how 128 relapse and refractory myeloma patients already exposed to 6 prior lines of therapy responded very well to IDCEL with a quite longer durability of the response. And important to remark that the efficacy was maintained in patients with high-risk features, those patients with extramedullary disease, plasma cytomas, or high-risk cytogenetic abnormalities, or a high tumor burden, and all these patients responded very well to the BCMA CAR-Ts. And the chronological age should not be any problem, because you have to know that patients older than 65 and even older than 70 were included in these clinical trials, and the efficacy was maintained. This is another BCMA CAR-T, Filta-Cel, also updated at ASCO and EHA Congress, conducted in approximately 100 patients with very promising efficacy data, because the overall response rate was almost 100%. This means that every patient treated with Filta-Cel achieved at least a partial response, and the complete response rate was almost 70%. This is the outcome in terms of progression-free survival and overall survival, also quite long and definitely unexpected for the population included in these clinical studies. And we had the opportunity to see an update at EHA as well as ASCO in order to see how the median progression-free survival could be longer than 2 years, what is unprecedented for the population included in the study. Safety profile is also different. You know that the BCMA CAR T administration may require right now, and especially in Europe, hospitalization for 2-3 weeks. And we have to take care about the cytokine release syndrome, frequent in almost all patients, but quite manageable. We have to take care about the neurological toxicity, but is much less frequent than the cytokine release syndrome. And it is also quite manageable in almost all patients. Cytopenias are also quite frequent, but this is something that we know very well how to manage. And you as patient have to receive adequate prophylaxis for bacterial, fungal, virus in order to prevent the infections development. But this is something important for you as patient. The quality of life the patients have reported in the clinical trials with BCMA CAR T's has been excellent. And the treatment expectation, as well as the comparison with the previous myeloma treatments, is excellent. You have to know, and maybe you know, that the BCMA CAR T's requires the single infusion. There is not any additional treatment following the CAR T cell administration, and this can also impact in the quality of life, but also because of the efficacy, almost all patients respond, and this definitely translated into an excellent quality of life. And together with the antibody drug conjugates, as well as the CAR T's, I have to present to you the bispecific monoclonal antibodies or the T-cell engagers. And I think that T-cell engagers is a very appropriate word because these monoclonal antibodies are going to target the BCMA, but they are going to engage the T-cell in order to go to the tumor niche. These T lymphocytes are going to be activated and they are going to destroy the plasma cells. And there is a long list of bispecific or T-cell engagers monoclonal antibodies. And you can see here in this list, 6 different BCMA bispecific monoclonal antibodies. The most important thing is that all of them work quite well in heavily pretreated myeloma patients. And this is very important because these are going to represent again another possibility to cover the unmet medical need we had when we had in front of us patients after a median of 6 prior lines of therapy already exposed and refractory to proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, and anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies. From the safety point of view, well, you have to know that the cytokine release syndrome is also present in this monoclonal antibodies treatment because when these T lymphocytes are active, they liberate, they release cytokines responsible of this symptomatology. Neurotoxicity can occur, but is less frequent than with the CAR T's, as well as infections, but you as patient will receive the adequate prophylaxis. How are we going to differentiate all these long list of T-cell engagers? Well, we don't know. We have to evaluate very well the efficacy, but we will compare them basically because of the route of administration. Some of them require IV, some of them sub-Q. You have to know that for the administration of these T-cell engagers, at the beginning, you can require hospitalization for the first doses in order to mitigate the cytokine release syndrome. But anyway, I think that these bispecific monoclonal antibodies will open the door to be treated with another different strategy than CAR T's, but targeting again BCMA. And this is a summary slide just in order to show how BCMA is an optimal target for multiple myeloma patients. We can target BCMA throughout immunoconjugates, bispecifics, or CAR T's. And you can see here some advantages and disadvantages for each of these approaches is because you know that immunoconjugates and bispecific are off the shelf, and these drugs are going to be in the pharmacy of each hospital available to be utilized in each moment, whilst the CAR T is much more personalized. And you know that we have to collect the T lymphocytes, and they have to be manufactured, they have to be modified, and this process requires approximately 4 or 5 weeks. But be sure that your physician will take into consideration these factors you can see here in this slide: the frailty, the disease morbidity, the risk assessment, the treatment history, and the lifestyle, in order to select the most appropriate BCMA targeted therapy for each specific patient. If we have to look a bit into the future, just to mention that belantamab mafodotin is being investigated in combination with many standard of cares, with bortezomib, pomalidomide, carfilzomib, and so on. So we will have the possibility of using in the future belantamab in combination with many different standard of cares. If we evaluate a bit the BCMA CAR Ts or the CAR Ts in general into the future, you have to know that many clinical trials are going on in order to try to optimize the efficacy of the BCMA CAR Ts. And we will have new targets, new modalities, and definitely this will open the possibility of building a curative platform for patients with multiple myeloma. And concerning the bispecifics and beyond CD38, SLAMF7, and BCMA, new targets in order to evaluate immunotherapy in myeloma. GPRC5D is also expressed on the surface of the plasma cells, as well as in the hair follicle, and talquetamab is a T-cell engager, but in this case, it is not going to target BCMA, but the GPRC5D. And the efficacy is quite impressive also with this bispecific monoclonal antibody. And this is another new bispecific monoclonal antibody. Its name is cevostamab, and the target is FCRH5, and also the efficacy is quite promising. So in summary, I would say that the immunotherapy is exciting for the management of patients with multiple myeloma. Now, this BCMA targeted therapy is restricted to late advanced stage of the disease, but definitely all these strategies are moving to earlier lines of therapy. And maybe the challenging question in terms of the future is what would the optimal sequencing be? And from my personal point of view, I think that every newly diagnosed myeloma patient in the future will be treated with proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, and anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies. And definitely it is possible to move this BCMA-targeted therapy throughout belantamab in combination, CAR T cells or T cell engagers to earlier lines of therapy. And definitely all this platform will put in context that we will be able to offer at least long-term survival for our patients with multiple myeloma, but I am completely sure that we will be able to offer the cure to some patients with multiple myeloma. And I stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.